Michael, thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to Lorraine as well. Before I answer that question, let us just look at where does ethics really fit in. Another word for ethics is beliefs, and if I believe something, if that is my approach and my belief, it's inside me. Now, your belief actually now helps you to how you look at the problem. That's the glasses that you look through. If you look at the problem, that causes you to think about it. That's how you approach it. Your thoughts then becomes eventually actions. Actually, your thoughts becomes emotions, and your emotions becomes actions, and your actions becomes habit. That eventually becomes your destiny. But it all starts with your ethical approach, those beliefs. What this book has enabled us to do is by reading it, we can see what is the role of ethics, but not only the theoretical role, the practical role in each of our lives. So I believe this book, that's about engineering ethics, is also about life and how human beings can fit and can live together. It is a lovely book.
Thank you, Louis. Does the three-pillar approach offer an original and reliable solution to the study of this academic subject for engineers?
Yes, the answer to that is yes. It starts off with your philosophy, your approach, and your beliefs. Then it takes it to some skills to say, how do you apply it? Not only what, the theory, how you apply it. But I think one of the strong parts of this book is the end, the third pillar, where we take it to actual case studies. And as I said in the video, on the actual case studies, we could see what are the consequences or the unintended consequences of doing or not doing something. So I believe this book spans from the knowledge through the skills to the practical application.
Yes, I totally agree. Practical applications is key in engineering education. Does the author take care in explaining the terms and concepts, and are these explanations clear and easy to understand?
You ask that for somebody that's part academic. Sometimes, and I think back about my own time when I studied, some of the concepts was explained, but it didn't really gel inside me. I could even pass the exam, but ask me exactly what does it mean? No. This book is one of the few books on ethics where I can really say, I've read it and it has opened a better understanding. And when I read it the second time, I realized, oh, what, I actually did catch it the first time. So I'm highly excited about the way that this book is not only structured, but by the language and the communication skills that was put in the book. So I believe that I would have been a much better engineer with much higher marks, Lorraine, if I had some of your books as a student.
I'm with you there. In your opinion, considering the academic ground covered in this book, could it become a recommended textbook in universities, TVETs, and for professional engineers undertaking the CPD points?
Michael, you made a mistake there. Not could, it should. That is, and this book is not only for engineers. This book is for the construction industry as well. But when do you start to teach? You start to teach children. You start to grow children when they are small. You do not wait until the engineer is in industry and say, oh, this is not ethical, this is what you should have done. So I believe it is absolutely crucial that a book of this specific subject should be part of the undergraduate studies of every engineer. There is no doubt in my mind. I just wish sometimes I could go back to university and redo a couple of other ethical things that I do at university as well. But I'm not going to expand on that.
Totally agree. Ethics should be a major pillar in engineering education. Thank you for your thoughts. It is greatly appreciated. Now over to you, Lorraine, the author. I would like to introduce you all to the author of this book, Dr. Lorraine Doherty, who is a specialist in engineering ethics and who has been lecturing the subject at WITS for over a decade. Perhaps you would like to share with us how this book came about.
Thank you, Michael. I think my main feeling behind putting a book like this together, I think in large part was I wanted a legacy. So I wanted to leave a footprint. I think that was probably one of the key aspects of writing a book. And secondly, what I also felt there was a need for was an academic template within engineering for something like ethics. It's very much right brain. Engineers have spent their lives using their left brain. Very rational. Everything's predictable because it's empirical. And when we look at something like ethics, it's of fundamental importance to them. But it's not using the skills that they've used for the last maybe 10 or 12 years. So I think what I really wanted to do was perhaps develop a template and know that future, current and future engineers would be able to understand ethics from a theoretical point of view and also have an understanding of why they're doing the things that they're doing. So I think maybe that hopefully answers the first question.
It certainly does. But we're going to get into more details now.
Oh.
In the first part of the book, devoted to moral philosophical theory, you have introduced both African ethics and environmental ethics. What were your reasons for this?
Difficult. The reasons actually were both academic and personal, I think. As you can probably tell from my accent, I wasn't born in South Africa, but it's my home, and I've been welcomed, and I'm extremely happy here. So there was a need for me to actually pay it forward, if you like, which was one of the reasons that I decided to write a chapter on African ethics. It was from the heart. But I think both African ethics and environmental ethics demonstrate the applied nature of moral philosophy. Moral philosophy is applied philosophy. And if something's applied, it's organic. It grows. And as Louis said, ethics is about values. Values are organic. Values change over time and through extrinsic forces. So especially when one looks at something like environmental ethics, we can see almost a change of 180 degrees. If we look at classical philosophy, medieval philosophy, very anthropocentric, man is at the top of the triangle, man is dominant, nature is to be used by us. It's instrumental. It has perhaps resources, be they minerals, be they plants, all to be used by us. Nowadays, our shift in values is such that we see the intrinsic benefits, if you like, of nature. We've become cost oblivious, rather than we're looking at we don't look at the costs anymore when we want to repair some of the changes that that need to be made due to perhaps our interaction with nature. We now understand that we're part of the web of life. So I think that's the first thing. When I look at something like African ethics, once again, we're looking at that change that we're seeing in philosophy. It's no longer considered Western philosophy. It might have been in classical times, it might have been in medieval times, but in contemporary times, we actually realize that there's more to ethics than a Western approach. So African ethics has become important in its own right. We're seeing the importance of community. We're seeing the importance of something like Ubuntu, which is hugely important in the country that we live. And in fact, it not only does it dominate many of the values, but we know that values inform action. So it actually informs the actions of African engineers. Engineers working in Africa.
The second part of the book deals with engineering professionalism. Explain how you chose the subjects for this section.
Thank you, Michael. As Louis and yourself know, there's three pillars to the book. There's theory, there's professionalism, and then that third pillar is the coming together of both of them. And I think what we now understand as engineers is that we work in a social context. So not only do we have professional standards, but we also have a responsibility to the communities in which we work. So in developing this chapter, I obviously looked at the professional standards that are expected. So it's compliance and governance, particularly from EXA. I also looked at risk and safety and the mitigation, because obviously when you're on site and you're involved in engineering activities, those are very important. I looked at public engagement, which I don't think comes naturally to engineers. But it's hugely important because they now have to communicate with the communities in which they are active. So whether it be having to speak to people about a new road that's going to go over land, or whether or not it's perhaps about a dam that's going to be built, the community needs to understand and be involved in the engineering activities, both now and what it'll mean to their future. So in putting together that second pillar, I've tried to think of all the aspects that would affect the professional life of an engineer and incorporate them in that chapter.
Thank you, Lois. Yeah, community engagement is key. You can't do anything without considering the society that you're going to be working in. How did you choose the featured case studies in the third pillar of the book?
That was an interesting one, actually, because for me it was a very interesting exercise, because I obviously looked at case studies that I felt particularly showcased some of the issues, ethical issues, that we have encountered on this continent. So I looked at the building of Kariba Dam. I looked at the problems that we had with the Ford Cougar, the car that kept bursting into flames. I'm sure we all know about that one. I looked at your industry, the aero industry. I looked at the 737 MAX, and the huge ethical issues with the software, and quite how unethical Boeing were with that one. And obviously it did crash in Ethiopia, which was an African issue, let's put it that way. So I tried to think of case studies that had an immediate reference point for engineers living and working in Africa.
Thank you. Fourth and final question. What are your future hopes for discussions and education on engineering ethics in South Africa?
What I'd like to see is, I think what we've been able to achieve in my work at the University of Witwatersrand, whereby ethics has become quite an important subject in the third year of studying for engineering. And I'd like to feel that it becomes axiomatic, if you like, to the life of and work of an engineer. Engineers need to understand what it means to be ethical. They need to develop or understand their own moral compass. And then from that, I would like to feel that ethical behavior would be extended into their engineering workplace. So I'd like to feel that we can both educate and inspire future engineers to use ethics in their decision making and be proud of the decisions that they make, because the values that they're using are values that are ethical.
Thank you very much. Thank you both. Thank you, Louis. Thank you, Lois. I'd like to open the floor to questions. First, if there's questions from our guests in attendance, and then we'll invite our guests who are attending the book launch online. So, anybody, any questions? Yes.
Hi, I do a monthly mechanical engineering newsletter. You said that this course has been offered for the last 10 years, Edwards, is that correct?
Yes.
And it's a mandatory?
Yes, it is.
So that implies that, if you like, older engineers out there were not exposed to ethics. They could perhaps, you talk a lot about young people, but would the older ones, if you like, not benefit more in a way of from this book?
I think they would. I'll answer from my perspective, and then I'll let Louis have a word as well. I think very much so. I think one of the things that we're seeing, not just in engineering, but in some of the other professions, things like medicine, things like banking, things like accountancy, those professions, we're seeing that perhaps people who've studied within the last decade have been exposed to ethics. People who have not studied, who've studied previous to that, they've not been exposed to ethics, and it's become such a cornerstone, I think, in so many professions. We expect ethical decision making from people who are professionals. Why? Because they're governed by professional bodies, and those professional bodies, they not only govern, but they expect compliance from their members. And if one looks at any ethics code, the two ethical approaches, if you like, which are fundamental to a code of ethics, is both virtue and duty. And I think that's covered in the book, but one expects virtue from professionals, and one also expects them to understand and demonstrate a duty to those that they serve.
I wasn't necessarily exposed to ethics and value systems when I studied, but I had to be exposed to it as part of my mentoring program as a young engineer. And it was sort of, you learn it on the run when necessary and if necessary, and if there's no time, you actually skip it. So for the more senior people, I do believe that this book allows us, I'm putting myself in that category without giving my age away, but I think this book allows us to catch up a bit. We talk about continuous professional development. This is one of the books that we need to read, because if you look at the title, it's not ethics, it's engineering ethics. It's very specific, so it's for us, for this profession. And the second thing, in an African context, there is no other book that has explained to me Ubuntu like this book has done. And there are pages that say, this is the positive, these are the negatives. It gives you the context of the environment that we find ourselves today in. Allow me to give you an example. I've come back 2 days ago from Zimbabwe. I was there for 2 weeks in December. Average load shedding in December was 19 hours per day. At that stage, the Kariba Dam went down to a level of 0.73% water that's available for hydroelectric generation. So they had to switch off their hydroelectricity schemes. They got a little bit of water now, went back at 4.5%. Last week, we had a better than 19. We were at 18 hours every 24 hours. Not per week, every 24 hours. They have already designed, they have already got all the plans, they've got the quotes ready for a new dam approximately 30 kilometers below the Kariba. The problem is now an ethical one of the people and their livelihood. But there's also another one that has now suddenly cropped up in the last week when I was there. And that is that second dam will let the water go up to 650 meters on the downside of the Kariba Dam wall. That is approximately 12 kilometers more than is allowed by UNESCO World Heritage Sites. So it's not only changing what is there and generating electricity. It's not only about the livelihoods, it's also about the entire environment. And that's what makes me excited. The environment was not at the top when I studied, it was you do the calculation and you apply the calculation to the benefit of the greater people. Today, we are much more sensitive and we're interconnected. So I do believe that this book is a good CPD book for many of the engineers in South Africa.
Thank you, Louis. Is anybody else?
Thank you. My name is Ansel Melen from Saimeki. Once more again, I just want to congratulate you on this book. I hear CPD and I understand that bridging the gap between the older and the younger professional must be through CPD. Like myself, I've been done ethics and all that. So what I wanted to know from you in terms of validation and reviewing of your CPD, have you already looked at it like that thing? Remember, when you do CPD, it goes to X and all that through validation and we get the number and all that. Have you already done that? If not, then may you give it to SciMakey so that we can do it for you. And we'll be building a good relationship with you. If not, but if yes, it's another story.
Watch that space.
So, I would love to work with you. Thank you very much. EXA have been exceedingly difficult to actually communicate with. So it leaves me feeling that there's lots to do. I just need to know that I've got partners that are committed to going forward with a project like that. I'm very committed. And if I can find somebody with a like mind, I think we can put together some very exciting programs. I really do. Thank you.
What is my hand?
Hi, Lorraine.
Hello,
Rob. I'm looking forward to reading your book.
Thank you.
Because I think what the position that you're in, where you are straddling, philosophy, ethics, and engineering, it gives you such a unique position, and the experience and knowledge that you must have gained in walking that unique position between and finding ways to communicate and to make your teaching meaningful from a philosophical perspective and to a practical perspective in engineering. And I'm sure you fed this into your book, but I'd like to hear more about just now what you've learned and how you've learned to communicate between the two worlds.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That's an interesting question. Thank you. I must say, I think where I was extremely fortunate was that when I arrived at WITS, they basically said, this is what we have done. Is it good enough? And I looked at it and I said, can I change it? And they said, yes, you can. And they were so supportive. So what I was able to do was hopefully teach an area of applied philosophy in terms of ethics and try and put it within an engineering context, within a workplace. And I think it was a challenge, but I think it was one I was ready for. Having spent most of my life in the workplace at that stage, I knew the kind of challenges there were. And I knew that the sort of enticements, if you like, that could be made that would be fundamentally unethical and which people might find very difficult to try and talk themselves out of if they weren't given the right tools. And so I think having been given that opening, if you like, I was able to build and develop a course, not just from my perspective, but also listening to engineers, listening to some of the challenges that they had. And then, if you like, using the philosophy to try and unravel maybe some of the challenges that they had and give them a template whereby B would follow A, C would follow B. I'm not saying it's necessarily linear, but it gives them a foundation and an understanding of why you say no, and not to do something if it doesn't fit your value system. Your job as an engineer is A, to be able to demonstrate your professionalism, but to do so within an ethical way. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Rowan, for such quite a great book.
Thank you.
I am Nelson Matanzara from University of Johannesburg. I lecture ethics and quality.
Oh.
So when I saw the part one of the book, I was like, okay, I think I'm on the right track. But most importantly, I like the way you have contextualized the case studies. Because in South Africa, you know, at the present moment, the issues that we are facing in terms of compliance, it's all about ethics.
Mm.
And which we find ourselves, for example, from a quality domain, we look at the product recall.
Mm.
Most of the issues, it's all about lack of ethical systems.
Mm.
Product that was not supposed to be released, but somehow they've been shipped to the market, and later on they have to be called. Although I feel like we need more in the context of different industries or profession per se, although now we have just captured from the engineering perspective, I hope the second book will cover more. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your kind words. It means a lot to me, especially when I think of all those hours that I sort of was writing and editing, then thinking, no, that's not good enough, scrubbing it all out and starting again. So I'm glad it actually made some sense. Yes, business ethics might be the next one. And I think very often what one sees, as you said, is engineers making decisions. Very often, especially if one looks at something like the Ford Cougar, those decisions, if you like, are made outside of Africa, and we don't actually have an African solution. And yet, it's our people that are suffering. And I think when one reads that case study and one reads the forensics and the forensic examinations, it's quite horrifying that Ford could perhaps have thought that poor man had perhaps been shot, or maybe he tried to commit suicide, and when one actually knows the true story, it's a very unethical way for an international company to behave, and to expect their CEO to actually operate on their behalf, if you like. So yes, I think there's we have African solutions. We don't need the global ones. We don't. I think we can operate quite ethically on our own. We don't need a global, unethical opportunity to try and apologize for the mistakes that other people have made. Thanks.
Thank you, and congratulations for writing the book. My name is Bird. I haven't had a chance to read the book, but already I'm embracing the fact that you're talking about the African perspective, and you keep looking at environmental issues. African perspective is very important, close to my heart, because I'm looking at the fact that right here you can easily talk with experts. You don't have that opportunity. I mean, you are not speaking about the regular person, but I'm actually, one doesn't have the opportunity to have professional bodies properly constituted to be your counterpart. You just alluded to the fact that you looked into the Kariba, I mean, is it the Kariba or the Zambezi Dam?
Okay.
Yes. That actually shows some environmental issues. I'm looking at the Great Renaissance Dam in Ethiopia. Now, we are hungry for development, but development comes with a few red flags and bottlenecks. Now, how does this book speak to the normal African engineer that I would like to benchmark with the rest of the world, actually looking at the bottom line with very powerful global companies that bring the promise for development to the expenses of the ethical and the environmental reliability or sustainability of those particular projects. I mean, I'm actually looking forward to read the book, and maybe did you have a chance to look into some of the study cases to some such of those, I mean, some of those issues, speaking to the African engineer beyond South African borders? Thank you.
Thank you for that question. I think indirectly I have spoken to that. And I think what I perhaps alluded to previously, but your question actually allows me to perhaps expand upon it in a little bit more depth, is that especially if one looks at some of the theoretical approaches, so if I look at something like virtue, for argument's sake, we're looking at, it's a very human-centric moral approach. We're looking at how we can be the best version of ourselves. And what it also demonstrates is that if one looks at virtue, there's not always a cost. We have two types of virtue. We have moral virtue and we have intellectual virtue. If I was to look at moral virtue, how much does it cost to be merciful? How much does it cost to forgive? Are we looking at a monetary evaluation, or are we looking at a personal evaluation? And I think when we look at engineering projects very often, because we're always looking at bottom lines, we're looking at an environmental cost, for argument's sake. I think you spoke about that, Louis. But are we looking at a community cost? Are we looking at how much it will cost the community to forgive us for taking their farmlands? Are we looking at how much mercy, how much that mercy will cost for them to say, okay, you can actually build over this ancestral burial ground? So I think, I don't know if that answers your question, but I think where, hopefully where the book will perhaps fill a gap is that decisions don't need to be cost-centric. There's also a need for you to come to decisions that don't, that aren't expressed in costs, in be it in rands, be it in US dollars or whatever. Maybe Louis, you could.
When I went through the book, we engineers have got this special language, we call that metrics. How do you measure success? And how I measure success and how I measure fairness could be completely different from how somebody else measures. But that book brings that discussion to the table. It puts the issue on the table. And it's the first book that's put the issues on the table in an African context. So it may be that the book doesn't answer all those questions, but what the book certainly does, it takes the questions and he puts it on the table and says, now it's open for discussion. Now it's open for robust discussion. And that is the start of any academic process. What do you do in an academic institution? You put the tables on the table. Some people say, we battle. We don't battle, we discuss it robustly. It's a huge difference. But by discussing it robustly, you're growing in your appreciation and your understanding. And this is where I would like to say that this book has grown my appreciation and understanding of the driving forces of ethics. And maybe I've read a book or two like that, but it's a long time ago. So this book has brushed off the bit of rust. Here and there I had to use an angle grinder to get rid of the rust. But this book puts it on the table. So that's why I'm so excited that it's now on the table. We're now going to discuss it. But now we're not going to discuss ethics. We're going to discuss engineering ethics, and we're going to discuss engineering ethics in a local African context, which is our continent. I'm highly excited. I hope you can see that as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any more questions from the floor? None? Any questions online? Okay. So I'd like to thank everybody for attending. I'd like to thank our author, Dr. Lane Doherty, Louis, for sharing your thoughts and your insights. It's been very interesting and engaging. So on that note, I'd like to let you guys know that food and drinks are available, but the book's also available for 260 Rand, and card and cash is accepted. So thank you everybody for attending, and yeah, we can applaud.